Why didn't they fight back? Why didn't they scream? These are questions often asked when someone discloses the sexual assault. These questions stem from a misunderstanding of trauma and its effects on the body and mind. We expect victims to resist, to fight back against their attackers. However, trauma often manifests in unexpected ways. Sometimes the most instinctive response to danger is not aggression, but stillness. This stillness, far from being a sign of consent, is a survival mechanism known as freezing. The absence of resistance does not equal consent. It's crucial to understand that a victim's actions during an assault are often dictated by fear and instinct, not rational thought or choice. The human brain, when confronted with extreme stress or danger, activates survival mechanisms that can override our conscious control. This can lead to behaviors that seem counterintuitive, but are in fact the body's way of coping with overwhelming threat. We often hear about the fight or flight response to danger. However, there are two other equally common responses, freeze and fawn. These four responses, fight, flight, freeze, and fawn, are instinctive reactions to perceived threats. They are not conscious choices, but rather automatic responses ingrained in our nervous system for survival. The fight response is characterized by aggression and a surge of adrenaline, preparing the body to confront the threat. The flight response involves running away from danger, seeking safety and distance. Freeze is characterized by immobility, a state of paralysis in the face of overwhelming fear. Lastly, fawn involves trying to appease the aggressor, complying with their demands to avoid further harm. Understanding these responses is crucial to comprehending why victims react in different ways during assault. Tonic immobility, also known as freezing, is a common physiological response to trauma. It is an involuntary state where the body becomes paralyzed, unable to move or speak. This response is triggered by the brain's fear circuitry, particularly the amygdala, which perceives extreme danger and activates survival mechanisms. During tonic immobility, the victim may experience a racing heart, shallow breathing, and a sense of detachment from reality. Their muscles may become rigid, making it physically impossible to move or fight back. This state is not a choice, but an automatic response over which the victim has no control. It is important to remember that freezing is a survival mechanism, not a sign of consent or willingness. Adding to the complexity of trauma, victims may experience involuntary physical responses during an assault, such as lubrication or orgasm. These responses are controlled by the autonomic nervous system, which regulates bodily functions like heart rate, digestion, and sexual arousal. It's crucial to understand that these reactions are purely physiological and do not indicate consent. The body, under extreme stress, may respond in ways that contradict the victim's emotional state and desires. This can lead to feelings of shame, confusion, and self-blame. It's vital to reiterate that these physical responses are not under conscious control and are in no way an indication of consent or enjoyment. Consent is an active, ongoing process that requires a clear and voluntary yes. Dissociation is another common response to trauma, including sexual assault. It's a mental process where the victim detaches from reality, their thoughts, feelings, and memories becoming fragmented and inaccessible. Dissociation is the brain's way of protecting itself from overwhelming emotional pain. During an assault, a victim might feel like they are watching the event happen to someone else, or they might experience a sense of numbness or emotional detachment. This detachment is a coping mechanism, allowing the victim to endure the trauma by mentally escaping from the unbearable reality. Dissociation, while serving as a protector in the moment, can have long-lasting effects on memory, emotional regulation, and sense of self. The aftermath of sexual assault is often marked by shame, guilt, and self-blame. Victims might question their actions, wondering if they could have done something differently to prevent the assault. This self-blame is compounded by societal stigma surrounding sexual violence, which often places the onus on victims to prevent assault. This shame and fear of judgment can prevent victims from reporting the assault or seeking help. They might worry about not being believed, being blamed, or facing retaliation from their attacker. It's crucial to foster an environment of support and belief where victims feel safe to come forward and share their experiences without fear of judgment. Consent is the cornerstone of any sexual interaction. It must be freely given, informed, enthusiastic, and revocable at any time. Freezing, dissociation, or any other trauma response invalidates consent. A person who is frozen or dissociated is not capable of giving meaningful consent. Modern legal definitions of consent emphasize the importance of active agreement. Silence, submission, or the absence of resistance does not equate to consent. It is the responsibility of everyone, particularly those initiating sexual contact, to ensure that their partner is actively and enthusiastically consenting to every aspect of the interaction. Scientific research on trauma, particularly in the field of neuroscience, is providing increasing evidence for the validity of trauma responses like freezing and dissociation. Studies using brain imaging techniques have shown how trauma affects brain regions associated with fear, memory, and decision-making. This growing body of scientific evidence is slowly changing how the justice system views and responds to sexual assault cases. Trauma-informed training for law enforcement, lawyers, and judges is becoming more common. This training aims to educate legal professionals about the neurobiology of trauma, helping them understand why victims might behave in ways that seem counterintuitive or contradict their testimony. Understanding trauma is not just about legal definitions and courtroom procedures. It's about fostering a society that responds to victims of sexual assault with empathy, belief, and support. Education is key to dismantling harmful myths and misconceptions about sexual violence. By educating ourselves and others about the realities of trauma, we can create a safer world for everyone. We can learn to recognize the signs of trauma, respond with sensitivity and support, and challenge the societal norms that perpetuate sexual violence. Ultimately, understanding trauma is a collective responsibility that requires empathy, education, and a commitment to creating a culture where consent is respected and survivors are believed and supported.